So
let's get started.
So welcome to Ruby Tuesday and JavaScript Meetup, Penang number 13. So probably brought to you by our KL Ruby Brigades, JavaScript Malaysia, EngineersMY. This is the link to our Meetup page and Slack if you want to get yourself invited. This one is Ruby Brigade. Yeah, it's a Ruby group. So you can get it in if you want. So Wi-Fi. So this is not a Wi-Fi. Wi-Fi is that one on the whiteboard. So get yourself Wi-Fi access. And then there's a link down there, bit.ly 2xnri4n. So this is the attendance list. Put your name, your email there so that you can get the lucky draw. Because I will be extracting the email from there for lucky draw on the JetBrains license.
R14
or I4, I don't know. So you put your name and email there and you are able to get a license from JetBrains for 1 year. To any products, all the products for JetBrains, including Python, Java, Ruby or JavaScript. Yeah. Okay. So good. And on the third column, remember to put whether you are which track you are going for. So you can put your either your Ruby or your JavaScript track. Let's put there. Okay. Good. All right, good. Okay. So that's good, then we can go for sponsors. So thank you for our sponsors, ACAT, for providing our venue, and thank you for JetBrains for giving us 2 license for their editor. So introduce myself. So I'm Rui, I'm the organizer of Ruby Meetup and JavaScript Meetup. So short intro, yeah, your name. Through our talks. So today we'll be going through the Ruby tracks, extract text from image, and then we are having our roundtable discussion. Okay, let's do this. Okay. I'll be switching between slides and code when presenting. So extracting text from image. So Ruby. So introducing Ruby. Ruby is object-oriented programming language. Everything is object in Ruby, including the string characters and numbers. So all have methods to call, and all are children of object class. So it's created by Masahiro Matsumoto. So he's the founder of Ruby language, and the why we use Ruby because of this. So instead of emphasizing the what, and I want to emphasize on the how part, how we feel about programming. So I emphasize the feeling, in particular how I feel using Ruby. So it doesn't want to work to make Ruby perfect for everyone, because everyone has different experience using Ruby. Ruby can do multiple things that you want it to be, and Ruby emphasizes on the happiness of developers. That's Max one to mention here. So next part we'll go to OCR. So OCR is optical characters. I think it's optical character recognition. So it's recognizing characters out of image. So how do you do that? Most likely you'll be looking at pixels. Then you train your models to detect your pixels. One tools in particular we'll be using today is Tesseract. So Tesseract is an open source tool by Google that you can use to identify characters, English characters, and then they expand to multiple languages also. So you can look at that. They can recognize pretty accurate, I would say. So let's do the code sample. So this is the GitHub that I hosted my code there. It's open source. So you can look at that. So let's go through the first thing. Big enough? How do you say?
Yeah.
Okay. So for Ruby, you will want to read from a file. So first, you need to require a path of name, and then open three mini magic. Mini magic is a GNU tool that you can modify image. It's I think it's a Linux tool that built in. So you can run Minimagic. Let's look at the gem file. So these are the library that you need. If you just need Minimagic, you just install with gem Minimagic. I'll be using Ruby 2.5.1, so it's a Ruby 2.5, and I'm using bytebugs to debug stuff. So normally when you want to start a project, you can start with a gem file to install all the libraries that we need, and then can start with the code. So let's go through the code. First, I define a class. So in Ruby, we can define a class using something like this. So class, and then initialize. So this is the init. Initializer for Ruby. Then you put in the input and output path. Next, you read. You read the image, you prepare the image. You open the file, and then you color space it. You make it into gray. Then you run, you write output, write to the output file. Next, you negate the image into black and white. So there's a threshold here. So you can set it to 007% using a magic tool convert. Okay. So when you do a a command from terminal. You need to run like tesseract, output path, SDDR out. So basically, this whole command you can run it on your terminal. So what we do is we're using OpenTree to capture the output, and then we put into these three fields. Then we only wanted to know the output of this command, so we get the text. And then we strip. Strip means strip the front empty space and the last empty space. Then we use DRR and KDRR to create the folder for the files that we want to write in. If the output is not there, the output DRR. So output is this, source is this. Okay. And then for each children, from the FBO path, so from the source directory, let's say you have four pictures in your source directory, so you need to loop it. This is how you loop. So you open it as a file, then you f.viewpath. Viewpath will give you an absolute path of the file. And then the textreader.new is the class that just now we created. Right. Yeah, so input path, output path. So the output path here, we put it temp directory means the output directory and base name. So at base name is the file name. Then we put read down case. Basically, we read the text reader, call the read function. This is a read function, and then we do a downcase. So it returns a string, then we downcase it. So let's run this thing. So it returns this string. So what is the image? So source. This is our image. So it's trying to negate it, so we can go to the output. Output is the negate part. Then you can see it negates everything and then it left the string. So the tesseract will able to recognize this string. So if we want to do some other tests, we can do. So let's say we do a screenshot. We do this as a random test one. And then we go to our just test one. And we put into the source. I remove the output so that we can see the things again. Run it. Yeah, you can see here. So after I run, it able to recognize this. So it misses out some of the stuff, right? You can see here. So Tesseract have a bit of inefficiency on text recognition on certain parts because they have a model that they train to recognize certain patterns on the image. So the accuracy is pretty good, just that some might be left out. So you can see here. It recognizes the second file, but the first file it misses one line. Still pretty good.
Can't see what's...
That one, it depends. Because some L, they have a curve at the top and the bottom, so they recognize that at L. Some is just one line, so it's very difficult for them to differentiate between like which one and which.
Does it consider like font, you recognize like different font type?
Font type, I don't
think. Like the font type, will increase
the depends. For Tesseract training, they don't have much font being fit into the models. So, I'm not sure about that. So this is the repository that do the recognize. So it recognizes 10 language out of the box, so you can try to use. So use case for this is like if you want to build an app that takes photo of a file and then send to your server to process. Basically, you can put a check, snap it, extract data from it, let user to verify before they send, rather than type one by one, you fill it up for them. So that's one of the use cases that you can use, right? It's pretty, I would say, it's quite some time already, since 2006. So they always train and keep update the models, so it's quite good. But you can train it by yourself if you want. They have ways to train it. That's Tesseract. Let's go for other things. So on Ruby, the author of this project, they mentioned about image magic to be less efficient compared to another tools called VIPS. So when they pit against Python, so Python also have image processing, Tesseract, so they run on it. Python appears to be faster than Magic, but when we use VIPS, VIPS much more faster because the image processing is fast. So if you want a faster processing image, you can use VIPS from Ruby. So this is the only difference, that you can increase the performance. Right. So if we want to see the performance difference, we can run this. We can run the time. So this is the without VIPS. This is with VIPS. So you can see the difference. So if you have more and more files to process, you will see this difference growing more and more. So Ruby can be done, can be used to trigger a lot of other stuff that we want to use. Like just now, we use image and then we trigger Tesseract. So if you want to do other things that the program from Linux, you can just put it here to run a bash command and then get the output. It's also flexible to do that. So for more information that if you want, you can go to this reference. This is the reference that I use. The code is not that outdated. You will get some bugs. You need to fix some, but you will learn while fixing those bugs. And this is the Git repository that I shared for today's slides and also the code. can go to here and look at the code and see how it's been done. It's very simple script, very simple code. Hope you're able to pick up Ruby and start to use Ruby with just a simple daily use that you want to do with your tasks, like extracting text from your files, doing other stuff with Ruby. You can use that as a template or boilerplate. So, okay. So that pretty much sums the talk, I would say. It's very fast. So if you have any question on OCR or extracting text, questions?
OCR is using that strike service.
Which one?
The OCR is using that strike service, right?
So OCR is optical character recognition. That's a term for the method.
He's asking whether or not is Tesseract an online service or is it a thing downloaded on the computer?
Oh, it works offline. You need to download the program down.
The latest Ruby doesn't work with the BNDS, is it? You have to be specific for that.
The latest Ruby, Ruby 6 or Ruby 2.6.
Because I'm having it here and then it can't install BIPS.
Yeah, maybe because it's too new. 2.6, 2.6 already released stuff last year already, right? Maybe the BIPS haven't updated yet.
It's like,
but
I'm using Windows as well,
I think it haven't updated yet. Maybe they haven't updated the code yet. Lip VIPS.
I didn't get the bundle installed about that, then I tried the jam install directly.
So it's
getting VIPS 8.8.0.
Oh, if it's Windows, it might not work. Depends, because it requires lip VIPS for Linux.
So is it like a different part of the Linux
team? Yeah, it's one of the libraries that's for Linux.
Okay.
So it's fast processing library with low memory. It's a more advanced image processing library. And this is just a wrapper to use that function. Okay. Anything more?
It's image magic and graphics magic.
There's also some example of Python also. You can try to look at how to use Python to do this processing. It's also there. Okay. Any more questions? Questions? Okay. So if no question, we'll move to the roundtable discussion. So what do I mean by roundtable? Let's close this first. So roundtable. So what we gonna do? So get questions from audience, provide help, suggestion to the question, any topic, any field, anything. So we have this session is so that because normally the speaker decides what is the topic to share, right? What is the material? Like, audience also want to learn something. Audience also have some questions for us. So we have 30 minutes for you to ask anything. And then we can pick up resource and talk about it, share directly here. We have developers here. We have people that work on different projects before that can give inputs to solve your problem quickly. And hope you can learn something or get your problem solved by these 30 minutes. Rather than people feeding you extra stuff, give a problem, we share and solve it together. You just need problems. Problem statement, anything that you want to do. Anything. Then we can start, make it into a talk. Any questions? Anything that you want to like to solve in your work, in your project, or need some help? anything, really anything. Because we've got 30 minutes.
Regarding to the OCR just now, I'm looking for something that could recognize the text, even when the text is grainy.
Okay, twisted.
It's 360 degrees. Because currently, when my project is, the text will not be coming straight. Sometimes it will be flipped.
Okay.
It's not straight, for example.
So for OCR, there's a lot of topics surrounding OCR. So if you do...
sometimes when the first array is from maybe 90 degrees, then the accuracy is very, very high.
Yes. So because when an image is fed to you, you cannot assume that every text is on the correct alignment. So there's a way to adjust your image. Every 45 degree, they will recognize a bit. 45 degree, recognize a bit. Then they turn, and then they flip. Totally flip, and then they flip it back. Then they do a contrast change to recognize. So, they do a lot of those in the OCR training, actually. So, I remember there's a talk on it. So here is some online solution that you can use. I believe they have free tier.
Yeah, it's
this is the fastest way you can get it. But normally you want the free one, right? Free one is here. So we have a Python OCR, Pi OCR, Tesseract there. So how does the OCR works? So these are the process we're looking at. In machine level, this is just the architecture on how they do the Tesseract. The OCR thing. They are using Java. And put it inside Docker. So let's see how they train. Font recognition. So you can see the font is different, like Illinois. This kind of font is very different from like our standard Times New Roman. How do you see? Tesseract was not programmed to understand the font in the image. So it became mandatory to identify the font, install and generate train data for the needed fonts. So you need to train for it. So how to train it? There's a link here somewhere. So we have PGESBot to install with training tools, Tesseract. Generate to create box and tip. Voice run Python script command. So basically it's create text. So you need a lot of samples. Lots of samples with the form. To train the models, right? So JTestBot is actually a sample creation. So it runs the fonts, generates a lot of like box and tip files. So these are image files. And then you run the Python trainer script. So I think for the resource, you can Google for this, build your own OCR for free. there's a lot of links here. We don't have time to go through every part of it. Can take a look and experiment with it. And hopefully you can share with us in the next few months on this topic after you learn it. Okay? Any more questions on Ruby or JavaScript specific? Okay, state management. You mean on UI or?
Or UI,
okay,
front end.
So I remember React or hooks.
So right now I'm actually using UX.
UX. Oh, I think there's a JS Conf Asia just recently. The speaker is sharing something. It's from Vue, the founder of Vue.
Even you.
He's sharing something of Vue. JS Conf Asia.
I think it's Singapore.
Yep. So it's about Vue. Yep. This guy.
So basically, I just everything tends to plump up into several files, and then they just grow on those files. So they don't become the modularized, idealized version they talk about.
So everything is a public file, public exposed YAML or public.
Something like public exposed modular, and then okay. Everyone just gets from each other. And eventually, I try to do some name spacing to separate them out. But then in the end, name spacing handicaps me where I want to get power from the other another part, which is like I have to jump through several loops before I can pass the data to that module, I would say.
Oh, okay.
So I'm like looking around to see how people actually do it now. Or like,
so it, must it be offline or it can be a distributed server?
Mine is offline on the offline PC. So right now I'm actually building the front end framework.
Okay, so you have issue people accessing the files randomly and then changing the states or?
I'm having issues like just maintaining all the data that goes through the application.
Oh.
So it's like more like how to handle application growth or anything.
Okay, so you have a lot of variables that shared across different states.
Yes, so now not yet that bad, but okay. Mostly it's like module functionality. Mm-hmm. So like this functionality I have it for this module.
Uh-huh.
And then I do not really can't get it to work on the other module. So at the end I write it on a duplicate member on that module to just go on and on. So I was like wondering how people do it for their
states management. Okay.
How do you just keep the states separate?
Anyone do states management before? Different states. I think Wills is using session, but that's a different topic. That's an online thing. We are using offline, so modular variables.
Is this a scalar? Because it's like quite a. And I understand that JavaScript is mostly applied on the web, web platform, but right now I'm using it.
Redis, do you check Redis?
You mean for React?
For Vue, basically store your states in Redis. You're using key values. So everything is key values. So when you insert, you just need to decide what keys that you want to insert. And then let them expire. If you don't need them,
it just expires.
You can set the expiry. Let them flush it. And Redis is running on RAM, so it's
fast.
Just that. Whether the states are important or not. If it's important, you can make it persistent. Persistent means every few periods of time, it will flush into hard disk to make it persist. But it's still, the cache is still on the RAM.
And Redis is for Ruby, right?
No, Redis can be anything. You can do Redis on anything. You can do it on server side, you can do it on Python, you can do it on Java, anything that you basically it's just a in-memory data storage with key values, and it's super fast. And it can scale. So you can do a cluster of Redis to load balance. A lot of messaging system, you know, that MQ and all those queue system, some are using Redis because it's so fast. You can take a look on Redis. Some of the caching is using Redis rather than memcache. Really, it works. It provides more functionalities compared to memcache. So Redis is a good one to, yeah. If your structure is very simple, just key values, this is super suitable.
Redis in Node.js.
Electron. I think got wrapper one.
It's a P3X.
Sure got one.
How you search it?
So you can try to look at some of the, maybe there are some wrappers rather than other than this one that suits your need. Because this looks like a PHP thing. Yeah. It's like a PHP thing. Electron Redis. Using Redis with Node.js. So, take a look at those. I would say it's pretty fast if you use Redis. You can spot a lot of structures.
Thanks.
Any more questions? Anything that you want to build? Any feedback that you need? Because we work on different projects, we come from different experience, we can share different ideas. You just need to tell what you want to know, then we can tell you also what we know. Questions? Anything that you want to learn? Because we have 30 minutes. Really, we have 30 minutes to solve your problem. For you to learn something.
I'm actually very new, so I'm still learning.
Okay.
I'm solo learning.
Yeah, good, good.
So, yeah. So let's say about completing all, what are some of the basics to be a real project? Really like?
You can create your own inventory system. Yeah, so Ruby on Rails is very good at form. So a lot of data-specific operations. So something like e-commerce. You can see a lot of e-commerce websites built using Ruby on Rails. Because they manage data very well. You can make sense of the data. So like you can look at orders client, orders seller very easily with associations. So we go to Ruby Rails Associates. This is the fun part of the whole Ruby thing, is the active record. So you can see that you have author, you have book. So you can do book.author, then it will give you the author rather than you query for table author where something. How do you do it? You can see this. Author have many books. Books belongs to author. Then you basically can call author.books. It will return all the books that relate to that author. Or book.author. Then it will give you the author thing. So that's the power of Active Record where people like to use to do data. So like who uses Ruby on Rails? What company? We say what company. Then you can see the similarity. First is Airbnb. all, like e-commerce, you have listing, you have relationships between each of the location and all those stuff, right? Then you have Crunchbase, also data related, also listing, and SFM is Bloomberg, so very data specific. People, this is like the GIF, the 9GAG thing. GitHub, it manages all the commits. Each project relates to commits, creates the users, relate. You can see those relationships. So, Ruby on Rails are very good at how to build the database relationship. So, if you look at other frameworks like Java, they have Hibernate. If you do Python, they have Alchemy. Those isn't that powerful yet. They are still growing, but they haven't reached that stage where when you type a line, like a sentence, to get your data, you need to modify your SQL in order to get what you want. Unlike for Ruby, you can get your data with multiple relationships very easily. So you can, let's say you have we have books, we have author, right? Just now, books, author, then you have payments. These are three different things. You can link books to author, payments to author. Then there's no linkage between books and payment, right? But with Ruby, you can define books as payment through user, through author. So you can call books.payment. Then you can get all the payments. It basically joins the tables for you in the back. You don't have to deal with that.
This thing is like filtering, but you get all the previous data from
the concept. Yeah. By writing the relationship, and it's very English-like. So when you write it, you know what it means for that line. Rather than you write the whole SQL and what I do, what it is for, you also don't know. So that's the thing, like Ruby is meant for you to define your code without comment. So when you write, you actually already comment in the code. When people read, oh, they know what you are doing already. If you write in C, you write in Java, you need to write a comment. Else people don't know what you are writing. Because the naming is different. Yeah. So I would say start building an e-commerce if you want. Start to the simple one is inventory system. Start with inventory system, that's the easiest because you have your product, your count, your amount of product left, then you need to update your product, right? Who buys, who sells, and all those are relationships. Then you learn about tables and tables. How do we do that? For that one, we have get my project. I worked with one project before. So there's a railroady. So I use this to generate all my schemas, the database schemas. Sometimes when you create a database, you don't have the visual view of what your tables look like, how they connect to each other. With this, it shows you all the things that relates to your tables. So if I open my models, this is all the relationship. You can see the lines. What use what foreign keys? Foreign keys. Everything lists down which key link to which key. Because sometimes you want to know, oh, this table links to which table. So this library allows you to see what how your tables interact with each other. You don't have to go to the code and see, oh, what is where is this link to which and which? You can use this and one shot overview.
That's after you have written the code and then you have
Yes. It generates from a database schema. So this is very useful if you want to show your team or developers what is the database look like right now. So what record you can delete, what record you cannot delete, how it links to each other. And it's, I would say, open. This is one of my projects. So we do a lot of relationships. So like, we have a user table, right? You can name your column called clients. Then you link to user, something like this, easy. So I have this link. So sometimes I put my comment in my code so that I remind myself where I get this information from. Okay. So how do you refer to the model twice? Like, if you have an order, you have buyer and seller, right? Both are on the same user table, but you don't want to call them user column. You want them to name differently, but links back to the same table. How do we do it? So this is the way that you can do, by defining the class name. Then when you call the order dot client, it will automatically know which record it will pull. So there's multiple ways that you can make your data much more bearable, much more understandable when you read it. So Ruby help you with that. That's the powerful side. In terms of, if you want to mention about performance, I would say that it can handle more than 1 million or 2 million of requests easily. Unless you grow more than that, sometimes you don't need that much of performance yet. You just want to push your feature and product out first. You need fast pivot, fast development time. So if you want to look at performance, there is like you have Golang, you have Java, you have C++. But how much time you need to make one changes, that's the thing. And suddenly, your feature change. One day you need to change. If you use those high performance thing, framework, it takes weeks to change because they are high performing. It's very coupled, deeply coupled to each other to reach a high performance state. For Ruby, you just go to one line and then remove it and change it. It's very quick to change your idea, change your feature, build a feature. It's more about speed to deliver rather than the real performance when you have a big audience. If you don't have the product, why care about big audience? Because you won't grow that far yet. When you grow that far, you already got a big team to build more things already. You don't have to worry about your app. That's why there's a big company using called Shopify. Shopify is the, I would say, one of the largest company that uses Ruby on Rails. They are still using Ruby on Rails. They're still using Ruby on Rails. So this is a big company, it's not small. They buy a lot of companies, they do things fast because they're able to deliver. Company want this, next day gone, already have. Because Ruby is that fast, you can build things faster, faster and faster. Then later worry about performance. Because performance is grow by time. A framework or a language will improve over time. So eventually you'll find a way to improve it. If it doesn't improve, you just throw money to a server and improve it. You just need RAM, yeah. Just need RAM, bigger server, you just throw money. You got money, man, you throw money. Because you grow big enough. That's one of the feedback I get from one startup in Texas. They are still using Heroku. Their monthly spending is like $2,000. They are still, they haven't think of switching out of Heroku yet because it's affecting them. If they switch to Amazon or Google, they lost that freedom. They lost that benefit of not managing their own infrastructure. because Heroku take care of that. They just need to focus on Ruby. They don't have to think of firewall, database, whatever. They don't have to care. They just build their own thing and then get their customer. The customer is paying for the infra. So you balance how you balance your profit. So most likely you will just focus on a product, build. And then if you have enough money, you can do extra stuff. Yeah, you can hire more people to handle things. If not, keep staying on the same thing. We have a local startup, Superhand. Oh, Heroku. It's the earliest one. Before Amazon offering platform as a service, they are the earliest. But they already shifted their servers to Amazon. So Heroku is actually powered by Amazon. If you look at their server, previously they owned their server by Rackspace. This is the earliest, and you still can deploy your app there for free. You can deploy up to six apps for free. And after you deploy, it can run on. It's basically there online, but using their domain. You cannot use your own domain until you pay. You can use your domain after you pay them. But they streamline a lot of stuff. They take the headache out from you. If your team is like one developer or two developer, this is the ideal one because it's cheap to start. And then if you grow, your customer grow, your traffic grow, your money also grow, then you can pay them more. If they become very, very expensive, then you can think of moving out. Depends. Because some of them really move up from because they want to explore like how to manage their own container, like Docker, Kubernetes. These are the technologies that are really hot right now. We have a Docker meetup in Penang, a Docker captain, and also soon we will have a Kubernetes meetup.
Kubernetes is more like you need to go to some scale before they start using it.
Yep. You need to know container first before you can touch Kubernetes. I use Kubernetes because my company required me to do that, else I will stick to Docker, it's easier. Start with Heroku, I would say. Deploy to Heroku, build your app there first. It's free. At least it's free for beginners, it's free. Then we can try out. Okay. Any more questions? We still have a bit of time. A bit more. Front end, you can use Ruby on Rails to serve your front end also. Or you can pick a third party like Vue, React, or Angular. The UI thing. Yeah, it's generated inside the Vue. So for Ruby, there's MVC. So you're mentioning the Vue layer. So the Vue layer is the thing that you see. So if you put something like this, it will display in HTML. It's basically ERB. ERB means embedded Ruby. You can write a Ruby code inside the HTML, but it's Java server rendered. So when it's displayed on the user side, it's actually just text or JavaScript. Yeah. And then something like PHP. If you know PHP, it's similar to that. So you can write the whole thing in Ruby on Rails, full stack, front end to back end. And now they have option for you to do React. So But I will say don't touch Webpack as a beginner, because it's a different concept. You need to understand how to run Webpack on the JavaScript side. So if you build React.js on Rails or Vue.js on Rails, it's different.
You have to configure, right?
Yeah, you need to configure a Webpack engine. So you need to learn extra stuff, right? Means you need to learn Vue or you need to learn React in order to build something for it. If you just purely use JavaScript, Ruby on Rails, you just need to know Ruby, HTML, CSS, JavaScript, that's it. But in the future, you might need, if you want to change, you can change the stack. You need to make some modification.
The
front end, the UI is HTML. Yeah, HTML, CSS, correct. If you want, let me see whether I can. So I can basically create an app and run it now, here from here, with just one line. That's the speed of developing on Rails. And then the UI is there also. I can show you where to change the UI files. Things is need to fetch some libraries from the, and I'm using RVM, so depends on what you prefer. There's two Ruby version manager, so there's one is called RVM. It manages your libraries and Ruby version differently. I'm using this. This is one of the oldest. Another one is RBEMV. This is a newer version to manage your Ruby environment. So you can run different Ruby versions like 2.4, 2.5, 2.6. And then switching differently from them. So, yes. Just now we say item. Item, we have name, the string, and then we have amount. So now I'm creating all the things that needed for my item, then I can run. So for now I just run three lines of code, and then I will have migration. Okay, what else? Forget about that. You need to run your DB migration. Means it implement the schema into your database. Then step back.
Server.
Four lines. I need four lines. Four lines to have this item A. Item back. I can edit, I can update, I can destroy, means delete it.
Yeah. So it's a design using the HTML,
it's inside. So where do you find this, right? Open. So the structure of a Rails application is you have an app. App you have view, then I have items. So this is the items table that you see, right? So just now you see index, right? So this is HTML, the table thing. So let's say I add item.
Did you write it? Did you write it?
No, it's generated for you. Everything here is generated for you. So, see, I just changed this, right? Okay. Now I go back. Is that?
So like this one, you say you need only two, because you say you use four lines to generate
yep.
that, right?
Correct.
The items you use for
it. Yep, it generates the.
You need to call the items.
Call the items as in?
Mm.
So the default controllers is index. This is the path. So you have index, show, new, edit. These are all generated for you. If you want to make any further modification, you can make it here. So it's fast. It's basically you just do first, then learn from what you do. So other things that you can do is rather than scaffold, you can basically do another one. It's called resource. It's the same thing, just that it's more lean, means it doesn't give you all the functionality. It only gives you the models. Like, let's say I have order. No need order, I have user first. User, then we have name, string, then email. So now I have user, but I won't be able to access from here. Right, because it gives me some of the stuff, but it doesn't give me all. Like, just see, the user is empty. There's nothing here, but it already gives you the routes. See the routes config. So, whatever you type in this bar, right, is actually referring to this file called routes. When we call resources, it's actually including show, index, delete, update, all those routes, the basic routes is included. Just that you need to write here. So if I write, I just want hello. Unknown format, okay. Render. JSON. Whether this will work or not, forget it. Need the key value. Data. So you can build your API here very easily with JSON, and then you feed to your mobile phones app, phone app. Yeah. So if you want to find a leaner way of doing Ruby, but that one requires another. It doesn't have active record built in, so you don't have that database flexibility. It's called Sinatra. Sinatra is used by GitHub in early days because it's just these lines. Then you have your app running on that path. It's very bare bone, means it doesn't give you anything, it's just very minimum. Then you want to add more, then you add yourself. Rails is it comes with everything that it thinks is the internet standard. The best way of doing things. So it gives you everything. This one, it gives you nothing. It gives you things that you can just run. So this is more bare bones, means if you want to make your app very lean to run on Raspberry Pi or very minimal things, you can do this. It's very small. Yeah. For Sinatra. It's also very early days. Any more questions? We have the images. yeah, need to put your attendance to get yourself a lucky draw on the license. This link. If you don't, if you haven't put your name there, then you don't have the lucky draw entrance. Okay. Any more questions to ask before I think it's almost time? So we have two licenses here, so only two person were able to get the license. We have five person here, so it's a very good chance that you'll get the license. Very likely. Okay. Good. Good. Okay. Okay, so I think I can end this whatever track, right? No one will be doing that. Okay. Tech tips. I think I have one. Let me see. Remember I put it here. Okay, this one. So on Rails, there's an active model dirty. So, means it can track your changes. So if you make a change on a view to trigger further action, so let's say you update the status, then how do you know whether a user update that status? You can basically implement a dirty using a dirty method here, whether it has been changed or not. If it's changed, then you can trigger some actions to do further things like trigger a payment, trigger a notification, and all this stuff. This is very helpful because it also gives version control. So if you don't like the change, you can revert. You can see name is bot, change, name change from new to bot. It will tell you what change from what to what. So you can know the history of your records. So this is one of the things that I found useful if you want to use detect some changes on your database column. Okay. Any more tips?
Anyone tried out the Windows terminal?
The new one.
I
don't know, let me check.
You.
Windows.
But it's good if you're using Windows. You can almost instantly access all your emulators.
This one?
Yes, I think it is this
one. Yeah, after they acquire GitHub, they have more things on GitHub.
More things to work
with. So, yeah. So
you can actually get it on the store, like, if you want to build it raw. You can get it from the Microsoft Store. It's a preview view, but I've been using it and so far it's been faster than Hyper or
PowerShell.
Using PowerShell, or I can switch between PowerShell, PowerShell Core, CMD, and do a flash. So the performance has been steady, hasn't broken down yet. At least crashes less than Hyper.
Okay.
Because Hyper uses electronics.
Yeah. Xmin? Do you try Xmin?
No, okay.
The older one is using Xmin.
Sorry?
Before Windows had the terminal thing, they use Xmin to get into those CD thing.
Yeah, that's
the
emulator, I think.
Uh-huh.
But that one is not native, right now we have one directly supported from Microsoft. So if you have a Windows, you're using a Windows platform looking for a terminal, can consider this on your Microsoft Store.
Good stuff.
And it's very configurable. It's like the config file is just like JSON only. So you just change.
Oh.
Very easy to use. The GitHub is a bit scary, but the Windows Store is just like download. It's just that.
It's good stuff. 1 hour ago. Wow.
Very
active. Very good. Very good. Good stuff. Windows Terminal. Try it. Good. Any more? No more? Okay. Like that. Next speaker. We need speaker for next month. Not July. Not July. August. We need speaker for next month. This is. Can I open the correct one? Yeah, open the correct one. August. Ruby track. JavaScript track. Or whatever track. Whatever track means really whatever. Anything from how to speak English. Okay, fine. Anyone want to volunteer for a speaker next month? Any topic, really any topic. Because next month, JetBrains will be sponsoring again. And I need speaker. Any more speaker?
Well,
can
ping
you later. Then, I can ping you later. Okay. Shoutouts. So there's a DTAC conf in Penang.
It was quite recent.
Yes, it's coming up on October. Last year is the first. This year is the second. First
she
and second.
Last year.
Yep. This year they have more topics on artificial intelligence, data science, cybersecurity. The speakers are good. Some of the tracks are good, so you can check it out. Tickets are there. I'll be doing a workshop there also on Ruby on Rails. October. So tell your friends if they want to go for a Penang-based tech conference. This is the one. Many of the conferences are in KL. This is actually for internet. So they can go and HRDF claimable means they can ask their company to sponsor and then they can claim back that money from HRDF. So do that. Use the company money. And it's on work day, so it's holiday for you also. So okay, let's see. And another thing is Facebook developer circle. So we will have a Facebook developer circle here in Penang soon. We have two leads here. I'm one of the leads. So we'll be running some Facebook related events here in Penang. So stay tuned. We will be doing something very soon.
How would you say Facebook related? You mean like you use Facebook API or use Facebook tools or is it a Facebook platform? Like?
They will give. I remember there's three tracks. One is web development with using Facebook technology like React. Second is data science with PyTorch. Yeah, machine learning framework, PyTorch. The opposite of TensorFlow. It's in Python. It's called PyTorch. What Facebook use for their machine learning. The last one, but yeah, there's a lot of things that happening in Facebook community and the reason, the purpose is to upskill people. So we have Connect, Learn and Code. Soon we'll be having events here.
I thought the biggest event from Facebook was the Libra Coin. Yeah.
They have branch in KL, but I don't think they have the upper circle in KL yet.
Huh?
Yeah, they don't have that yet. In Penang, we are quite early to get that. So stay tuned for Facebook related events. Hopefully they will give some slides. Hopefully. Okay. So Lux, let's take attendance and also talk to me if you want to like help out in any tech meetups in Penang. We have a lot of tech meetups in Penang, like we have data science, we have Python, and tech ladies. So all of those we needed volunteers help. So if you want to help, I can link you to those organizers. Okay. Okay. Next thing. I like to draw. Really? Can only choose one only, bro. Can only choose one. Make your change. If not, they will automatically become the winner.
Track is what? You choose what you want.
No, no, no. Track is the what developers are you.
Okay.
Only you can pick one. Only JS or RR? JS or Ruby? Only two tracks.
Python, yeah.
Okay, now. Because they sponsor only two tracks.
Yeah.
Wow, two names. Hmm. You can change first, then I go and see the thing.
I don't know.
Let me remove the sample thing. Lucky draw.
Directory, yeah. Like, usually cannot get this to work like remove directory, they always it always complains that there's something
permission. Oh, yours is?
No, it's like for when I'm using Ubuntu, RSV, it's always fails out, then I never remember the way to actually
delete it. Yep, there's a extra dash R command. Don't RF. RF you will regret. Okay, so for Lucky Draw, for Ruby, we have Ruby, for JS, we have JS. It's very simple thing, let's look at the code, it's pretty straightforward. Two lines, not much to see. Let's see the Java. I don't know how to make it exciting, also this is the thing that I found on Stack Overflow. So yeah. Because we don't have much choice also, we have, oh, we have 3%, okay, then only 1%, never mind, I can add myself into it.
That is competition.
Yes, cannot automatically win one. One is Ruby on Rails, one is just pure Ruby. So we go for this one. Hopefully you can directly paste. I don't know whether you can directly paste or not. Try. Okay. Like this can go out. How to do many rounds? For in I forgot already. In Java, how to do loop?
So for let I then I something then my customers.
I
equals to zero.
Okay.
You use the what semicolon?
I is less than. Let's see. 2019 lah,
but
our computer is fast enough. Okay. Not this one, it should be up there.
Put it inside so that we can see who missed. Okay.
Who missed the thing? Let's see. This is the view, right? Let's see whether that's an error or not. It's very random choice because it's one, then it's very. It's random enough lah. Times 3 is always 3, oh. Cannot this one. Really random. If it's random, it should be 0, 1, dot, dot, 0. Also cannot. Cannot.
Because
it's 0 to 1, then it's like in decimal points, then you can actually still get 1 or 2. But very high chances will be on. We have 2019 times. That one I don't know really. It's a discount code where you buy a new one, they will just use that discount code to discount the whole price.
I suppose as long as the expiry date is still valid, then
you
just
hold on
to it
until
then
you
should expire.
Yes.
Yeah, this one. Okay, you look at the code already, no problem, no hanky-panky. Satisfied with the code. It's very short only. So, this is for JS. Let's look at the Ruby one. Same thing. Send you to your email because on review then later everyone think cannot.
Is it like Facebook? No,
it should be email.
So on the right side of the block the screen. Yeah, just go there.
Yeah.
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 Okay. 1, 2, 3. Alright.
Okay, good.
I mean the photo is good.
Okay, so the next one. JavaScript track. So I use Node.js. Lucky or yes. Terence. Yay! Oh, the percentage.
Still can't. that's a bit more to stand in the light. Okay. Yeah, that's good. That's good.
Okay. 1, 2, 3.
Yay.
Hey, thank you. So I will send you email on the code. That one also. Thank you. So thank you all for being here. See you in the next meetup next month. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Let's end the session.